If you have your Bible, we're going to be looking in the Word tonight. So open your Bible, if you have it, to the book of Acts in chapter 10. The book of Acts in chapter 10. You know, if we were to talk about Jesus to just about anybody in the world, regardless of whether they're Christian or of some other faith, most people have some knowledge of Jesus now in the world, and many religions have actually included Jesus in some form in their understanding. They acknowledge he lived, and the one thing that, whether it's Islam or Hinduism, Buddhism, Sikhism, and most of the other major world religions all acknowledge that Jesus was at least a great prophet. And one of the things that is roundly recognized outside of the Christian world is that this historical person, Jesus of Nazareth, was a miracle worker and a healer. And the reason for that we won't go into tonight, except to say that the testimony of that healing is so prolific, not only in the letters in the Gospels that we have in the New Testament, but also in extra-biblical literature, including the writings of one of the most famous historians and the most well-attenuated historians in world history, Josephus, who spoke of him as a healer. And so Jesus and healing are connected in the minds of just about everybody. But it's unfortunate that in the Church of Jesus Christ, we kind of see Jesus as a healer in history, but we have kind of lost our trust and confidence that he's still a healer today. And just like there were sick people 2,000 years ago, there are sick people today. And just like there were people that were struggling in their minds and their emotions, and they were struggling with all kinds of pain and brokenness, then, well, we have a lot of broken and hurting people today. Would you agree with me on that? And there's a scripture that says, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if he was a healer then, he's still a healer today. And I'm convinced, I don't know why, you know, some people receive a healing miracle and some people don't seem to receive right away, or sometimes live out their lives and never see the full manifestation of the promise. I'm not going to answer that question, because really no one who says they have the answer does. But here's what I do know. He's good. And he is a healer. And if we'll approach him in faith, we'll receive from him a touch. And that he heals sickness, he heals disease, he heals cancer, he heals backs, he heals knees, he heals blood, he heals brains, he heals drug addicts, he heals people that are so brokenhearted they feel like they can't even get their heads off the pillow. Jesus has taken, I've watched him take people from absolute despair into hope and joy, and he can do it for you and for your family. So we want to talk about what the Bible says about Jesus as a healer and set the stage so this week, no matter who's ministering, we're ready to receive it. Now, the first thing I want to say is this about Jesus, is God anointed Jesus to heal people. In the book of Acts chapter 10, notice with me, Acts chapter 10 and verse 37, we're picking up in something in a description that's being given by Peter, the apostle, who's talking to a group of Gentiles about Jesus. And he says in verse 37, that word you know, or message you know, which was proclaimed throughout all Judea, that would have been where the Jews lived at the time, and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached. That's John the Baptist. So the word you know that was proclaimed. Here's the word. Here's the message that was preached, and even the Gentiles had heard it. Verse 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with what? Power. That word power is the Greek word dunamis, which means, it's where we get the word dynamite, explosive power. Power that changes and upends things. Power that disrupts the ordinary course of nature, miracle power. And he said that God anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were what? Oppressed of the devil, or by the devil, for God was with him. Now, the first thing I want you to see is this, that idea that Jesus was anointed and that Jesus was a healer and that Jesus saw sickness and afflictions as an enemy was a message that was in the gospel in the first century. And it was preached not just in Jerusalem and Judea, it went to the Gentile world, it went throughout. Anybody that knew about Jesus knew that he was anointed to heal people. And that, notice, I want you to notice too, he recognizes that healing was good. Doing good and healing. Everybody say healing is a good thing. Somebody said, well, I've seen the Lord use sickness. I know that God can use anything. That doesn't mean that's his ideal. I've made a lot of stupid decisions in my life that God used to teach me something, but it would have been better if I didn't make the bad decision to begin with, right? So there are things that even the enemy, and the Bible says here, in this case, sickness, he's recognizing that sickness and infirmity and pain and these things that come with the human condition originated in somebody besides God. They originated in the devil. Now, they didn't originate in God because God anointed Jesus to heal them from the oppression of the devil. And so if God sent the sickness, then God would be working against himself. You see, you've got two people here. You've got this invisible force called the enemy or the devil that in one way or another is responsible for bringing into the human experience all kinds of illness, disease, infirmity, pain, and all the things that we experience came not from God's perfect plan or from his heart, but from this devil, this enemy, this invisible force that's arrayed against us. I'm not saying that everybody that has a cold or everybody that has a pain in their back, that there's a demonic spirit that's doing that, because in most cases there isn't. But what we are saying is that the condition of sickness and pain and emotional brokenness in the human condition came not from God's heart, but from a strategy launched by the devil, by an evil enemy of God. And so God anointed Jesus to deal with that. And I want you to recognize that when Jesus returns, and it says that Bible says he's coming back soon, when he returns, he's going to bind the devil and throw him into a place called the lake of fire, and nothing will ever again be able to hurt or destroy. So notice that the removal of human suffering is totally from the earth is connected with the binding of Satan and his removal from the earth. See, it all started when he crept into that garden in the beginning in Genesis chapter 3 and deceived the first humans, and he's been working ever since. But Jesus began the process of destroying, dethroning, and removing him from human experience. He paid the price with his blood for the finished, complete removal of Satan, but he's doing it in stages. And right now, God is confronting the work of Satan in the earth through something called the church, his people, the body of Christ. So it's important for God's people, Christians, no matter what their denomination, for us to believe that God is a healer. We need to believe that Jesus is a healer. If we don't hold on to that belief, then God isn't going to be able to use us to deal with the enemy in this time that we're living in. Say, God anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil. So let's take a look. I want to actually go back into the scripture and show you where this happened, because he's actually describing the anointing of Jesus by God at the baptism of John. Notice the baptism of John is mentioned in the previous verse. So let's go to Luke chapter 4. You can handle some teaching tonight, right? Look in Luke chapter 4. In Luke 4, we have the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And the scripture said that Jesus began his ministry by getting baptized in the Jordan River by John. And that when he was baptized, the Holy Spirit came upon him and God anointed him. And then it says immediately the Holy Spirit drove Jesus or compelled Jesus to go into the wilderness where he was tested, tried, and tempted by the devil. Isn't it interesting? As soon as Jesus is anointed by God, he's got to face the enemy. And it says in the scripture that for 40 days, Jesus was in the wilderness. Now, the Judean wilderness is, we think of a wilderness like a forest. The Judean wilderness is a rocky, mountainous desert, but not with sand, with rocks. You look, it looks like sand until you get up to it, and you just realize it's all rocks, craggy rocks and mountains. And Jesus went into this Judean wilderness for 40 days, and he confronted the enemy. And he was fasting, and we won't go into all that happened, but Jesus was victorious. He got through that testing. And the scripture says that after the 40 days was ended, and this is where I want to pick up in verse 14, it says, then Jesus returned, what does the next phrase say? In the power of what? The Holy Spirit. Now the Spirit came upon him when he was baptized. But when he went through the testing and he faced the enemy and defeated the devil, then he came back in the dunamis of the Spirit. It's the same Greek language that's used in Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit, that was at his baptism, and power, that is when he came back from the wilderness. Now the Spirit and power was upon him. Now the power, the dunamis power of God, wasn't for Jesus. It was for Jesus to minister to people. God anointed him with the Holy Spirit and dunamis so that he could go about doing good and healing. So he comes out of the wilderness having been baptized by John, confronted the enemy, and now the power of God is flowing in his life. Listen, if you have been through some trials, some tests, if you feel like you've been facing the devil himself, don't feel too bad. Jesus did it before you did. And listen, sometimes we have to be tested in some things before we come forth in the full power that God has for our future. And so Jesus came out with this anointing on his life. Now notice what it says. And news went out throughout all the surrounding region. And so what did Jesus do? He's anointed with his power. We saw in Acts 10:38 that it was healing power, power to restore humanity who's been broken. But the first thing he did in verse 15 is what? He taught. Now, I'll just make this mention of this. You can go and check this out if you have a concordance or you want to look through the scripture. But you will find that if you were to take all the things that the Bible says Jesus did, healing, casting out demons, raising the dead, all of those things, turning bread into multiplying bread, turning water into wine, all those miraculous events, if you were to list them all, you'll see they fall into four basic categories. The miraculous, the driving out of demons, and then preaching and healing, or preaching and teaching. And you will find that in the four Gospels, Jesus did more teaching than anything else. In fact, most of the time in the Gospels, it said he went about teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. He put his teaching ministry ahead of his preaching ministry. Now, what's the difference between teaching and preaching? Preaching is proclaiming something, telling you that something has happened or announcing something. Teaching is explaining. Jesus was a teacher. That's what I'm doing right now. I'm teaching you from the Word of God because teaching lays the foundation for people to receive from God. So Jesus is anointed with the power of the Holy Spirit. He comes out of the wilderness, the power to heal is on him. But he doesn't start there. He starts teaching. That's why we're starting tonight with teaching. Teaching in their synagogues. And notice what it says. So he came to Nazareth. So he's going throughout, and he was glorified of all. He comes to Nazareth, which is his hometown where he'd been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath. Everybody say it was his custom. That means he did this all the time. Notice he went to church every synagogue, every Sabbath. Jesus didn't skip church. He didn't say, oh, I'm the Son of God, I don't need it. He didn't say, I went to church enough growing up, I don't need it. No, Jesus went to church. It was his custom every Sabbath. And he was ready. So he goes to the synagogue, and we go to Israel, and just to hopefully we'll be able to announce soon. We go to Israel, we're going to go right to the synagogue. The actual first century synagogue where this happened has been uncovered. The stones still feel anointed to me. And he went into this synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah, or Isaiah as we sometimes say. And when he opened the book, he found the place where it is written, and he starts reading. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to what? Preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me, notice, to heal the what? Brokenhearted. To proclaim liberty to the captives. He thinks of people who are oppressed or those who are sick or those who are struggling as captives of an enemy. And recovery of sight to the blind. That's first of all physically, but it's also a metaphor for spiritual sight. It's both. And to set at liberty those who are oppressed. It's the same Greek word in Acts 10:38 where it says he healed all who were oppressed of the devil. Same Greek word. So he's anointed to heal both the bodies and the hearts and the minds and the souls of people. The brokenhearted and the broken people who are broken physically. And I want to say this to you. The same anointing that can heal your disc in your back, the same anointing that can heal your cystic kidneys. Somebody in this place is here with kidney cysts. You've got growths on your kidneys. On the left side, it's worse than the right side. Doctor said it's going to continue to get worse, but the Lord is here to tell you this right now. He's already begun a healing work in your kidneys. He's restoring those kidneys to perfect health right now. You'd be amazed what God's going to do just while we're preaching. You know, a lot of the people that were ministered to and healed in Jesus' ministry happened in the middle of his preaching and teaching. Hallelujah. And notice the last thing, verse 19, he said, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, that's a good translation, but in English, it doesn't fully give the Hebrew. In the Hebrew, it says to proclaim the year of God's favor has arrived. The year doesn't mean a 365-day year. It means the era of his favor. So this is a new day. This isn't a day where the law of Moses judges those who are guilty and those who are not. This is a day where grace reigns and where God's favor reigns. And God's favor is open to anyone who will come to God in the name of Jesus. It's the year of the Lord's favor. And that means God is favoring anyone who is brokenhearted to be healed, anyone who is oppressed to be set free, any captive to be liberated. Jesus is here to heal any person who's got blindness. He wants to heal people, and it's the year where God is disposed to show favor. Now you've got to picture this. Here they are, first century synagogue. Jesus is reading this familiar passage from the prophet Isaiah. And then notice what it's, I love the drama, verse 20. Then he closed the book, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. Now in the Jewish synagogues, you'll see this when you go with us. In the first century synagogues, there is a place called the Bema where you would read scripture. You would stand to read scripture, just like a pulpit in the middle of the synagogue. But then behind the pulpit, right here, was a seat. It was called Moses' seat in every synagogue. And so the preacher would actually sit down. They'd read the scripture from the pulpit, the Bema seat. Then they'd sit down in Moses' seat and they'd teach. So it's okay to sit and teach. So when he sat down, now his sermon comes. They all understood that. You read the scripture from the lectern, then you sit down to comment. So here's his sermon. He just read from Isaiah. Now he's going to sit down, and here's his sermon. I love it. It's a short one. He didn't always preach short, but this time he did. And it says, and the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. Why were they fixed on him? Because now he's going to comment on this. And he began to say to them, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. In other words, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to set at liberty those who are bruised, to open the eyes of the blind. He's anointed me to heal y'all. Amen. Now, how do you think they responded to that? Well, it says that there they all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which came out of his mouth. They said, this is an amazing message. But then they said, is this not Joseph's son? In other words, they start saying, wait, we know this guy. He can't be this. This is the Messiah. He's not the Messiah. He's the carpenter. He was raised in his daddy's shop. Who does he think he is? So Jesus, knowing everything, said to them, surely you'll say to me, physician, heal yourself. Whatever you've done in Capernaum, do here too. They'd heard about him doing some miracles in Capernaum. He said, do it here in your hometown. And he said, assuredly, I say to you that no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you truly, and now he's going to give us two illustrations. I'll just run through them fast. Many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was great famine in the land. And to none of them was Elijah sent, except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. Let me just unpack that for you real quick. It's in 1 Kings chapter 5. And so Elijah was an Old Testament prophet who proclaimed that God was bringing judgment on the land, and there was a drought. And the Lord spoke to Elijah and said, now listen, I want you to go to Sidon. There's a widow in Zarephath who I'm commanding to feed you. In the Hebrew, it says, I am commanding. So now what you need to know is Sidon isn't in Israel. Sidon is in Phoenicia, way up north in the pagan land. God told Elijah, get out of the Holy Land. I want you to go to a place where there are people that worship other gods. And there's a woman there that I'm commanding to take care of you. You know, sometimes the blessing of the Lord is not in the place that you expect. So Elijah went all the way up to Sidon in Phoenicia, goes to Zarephath, finds this widow, and you think, you know, by what you just read, that she recognizes Elijah. She says, oh, you're the prophet the Lord spoke to me about. No, she is just gathering some sticks, getting ready to make her last meal because the famine went all the way up to Phoenicia. And so Elijah says to her, basically, listen, what are you doing? And she says, well, I'm making a final meal. I have just a little bit of flour left and a little bit of oil. I'm going to make a final meal for me and my son, and then we're going to die. And he said, no, listen, I've got a better plan. Here's the plan. You go ahead and make the fire. Now, she's starving, you know. You make the fire. You take that last bit of handful of flour and that last bit of oil. You go ahead and make a cake for me first. And she's like, yeah, what would you say? Who are you? What are you talking about? This is, you know, cue the violins. This is sad. I'm about to die. And you're, you know, if this was a preacher today, ooh, what you'd see on CNN, they'd have an investigative report on Dateline. I mean, it would be a big deal. Be on 60 Minutes, this preacher that asked people who don't have anything to give something to him first. But I want you to listen. He said, you take care of my need first, for thus saith the Lord, the bin of flour shall not be exhausted, and the oil shall not run out. Now, here's the amazing thing. In many ways, she was dying, which meant she was sick physically because she hadn't had proper nutrition. You know, that is a form of sickness, right? Her little boy probably had a big distended belly. They hadn't eaten anything. And she had to do something first. So she did. That's the amazing thing. She did it. And she made a cake. And God supernaturally multiplied that so that when she rose up and did by faith what the prophet told her to do, suddenly there was provision. And for the rest of the famine, they ate like kings. They didn't run out. What I want you to see is God said to Elijah, I've commanded or I'm commanding a widow to feed you. And even though God had a plan, that widow had to participate in the plan. And the prophet gave her a test, and she had to first do something which wasn't a work to qualify her for the healing or for the provision. It was a demonstration that she trusted God. So go back to Jesus. We're sitting in the synagogue. Jesus is being questioned now. And he said, there were many widows in Israel in those days. But the prophet didn't go to any one of them. He went to a Phoenician woman because the implication is she had faith. She received the prophet. Let's keep reading. Verse 27, and there were many lepers in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and to none of them were cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. Oh, I could get off on this one. But the Syrians were next to the Phoenicians in the north. They were idol worshipers. They sacrificed their children to demon gods. They were not in any way people that were favored by Israel. In fact, very often they would attack the Israelites. They were hostile pagan people. But there was without going into all the detail, this is in the book of 2 Kings, the Bible tells us that Naaman, who was the commander of the Syrian army, was a leper, and they heard there was a prophet in Israel who could bring healing. And so the Syrian king said, hey, listen, go down to that Jewish prophet and see if he'll do something for you. So Naaman comes down with all of his men, his big regalia, all of his army. The scripture describes it. He comes down, and here's Elisha, you know, just in this little place, and he comes to Elisha the prophet, and we won't go into all the detail. You can read it yourself. And basically, he says, I've heard that you can heal. And Elisha doesn't even come out and talk to Naaman. He just says to his servant, he said, listen, go tell that guy that if he'll go and dip 7 times in the River Jordan, if he'll just dip himself 7 times, he'll be healed. Elisha's servant tells Naaman. Naaman is angry. He's like, who is this little? And there was a lot of, I'm going to give you the attitude that would have existed in the Syrian mind. Who is this Jewish nobody prophet who's telling me, the commander of the Syrian army, a much more powerful army, and they look down on the Israelites, who is he to tell me to go dip in the Jordan River? In fact, he actually says, there are many rivers in Syria that are clean and much more beautiful than the Jordan. The Jordan River is not very magnificent. It's more like a dirty stream. I've been there many times. I've been baptized in it, I know. And there's even little fish in it that bite your legs when you get baptized. I'm not kidding. People want to get baptized in the Jordan. It's a dirty river. And so Elisha says, go dip in the Jordan River. And he said, he takes off. He says, that's it, I'm leaving. He's offended. But one of the servants of Naaman says, now listen, if the prophet had told you to do some magnificent thing, make a sacrifice or give all this money to this person or do some big thing, would you not have done it? But he asked you to do this little thing that doesn't make sense. Why not give it a try? So Naaman says, all right. So Naaman goes to the Jordan River, and he gets in this dirty Jordan River, and he goes down 7 times. And he's a leper. He's got this terrible skin disease. And he dips 7 times, and the 7th time, it says he comes out, and he was completely clean, completely healed. Now, God healed a Syrian who had no real covenant with God or basis to be healed. But I want you to see that the healing mercy of God went to that man because he was willing to act on the word. He was willing to rise up and do something. So Jesus tells that second story. Are you with me? Just hang on. This will be good. You'll be glad. This will be good. Just stay with me till we're done. And so Jesus says, he tells these two stories from the Old Testament, and he makes this point in verse 24 that no prophet is accepted or received in his own country. In other words, it's not that they couldn't have received from Jesus, but because they were not willing to see God in Jesus, they weren't willing to go beyond the natural doubts in their minds, they couldn't receive the miraculous anointing that was on Jesus. The power of the Spirit was on Jesus to heal and deliver them, but because they were diminishing the methodology, it didn't make sense to them, they weren't able to receive. And I'm going to suggest to you that what was true in those days is true today. That there are people, even people who are Christians, now, there were many Jews that didn't get the miracles, but these were two, we would say, Gentiles who didn't have any right to the miracles, but they got touched because they were willing to act in faith. And the same thing is true today. There are many Christians that God wants to heal and deliver, but they're so naturally minded that they've lost their trust in the ability of the Lord to heal them. And what I want you to see is God is not only able, Jesus is not only anointed, he is ready to do a great work in your life, a healing work. Whatever it is that you need to be healed from, he wants to do it. He's anointed to do it. But sometimes, first, There has to be a response on the behalf of his people. We have to rise up and be healed. We have to change our posture. We just can't be pathetic and say, oh, I wish he'd heal me. We need to rise. We need to step forth in faith. Praise the Lord. Now, all through Jesus' ministry from this point forward, you're going to see healing start to operate. Look in chapter 5 of Luke, just real quick. Just look in chapter 5 and verse 17. Now, this is after chapter 4, so we're going right into, he's coming out of this experience in Nazareth, and now Jesus is going to start operating in power. Verse 17 says, now it happened on a certain day he was teaching. Everybody say he was teaching. And there were Pharisees and teachers of the law sitting by who'd come from every town of Galilee, Judea and Jerusalem. And read this out loud. The power of the Lord was present to do what? To heal them. So there must have been sick people, hurting people, brokenhearted people that were there in that service. Jesus is now in Galilee. He's teaching. He's teaching the word. And not so Jesus is there, and the power of the Lord to heal is there, but nobody's getting healed. They're just listening, but they're not receiving. Then behold, men brought on a bed a man who was paralyzed, whom they'd sought to bring in and lay before him. And they couldn't find how they could bring him in because of the crowd. It was so packed. There were so many people listening. So they went up on the housetop and let him down with his bed through the tiling in the midst before Jesus. Now, I want you to notice, they didn't just stay in the back. They did what they had to do to bring the man. They wanted the miracle, and they were willing to act in faith enough to do something that was a little out of the ordinary. Maybe very out of the ordinary. I mean, he's in the middle of his message. And it says in verse 20, when Jesus saw their faith, here comes this guy down on the stretcher from the roof. And when he saw their faith, not just the lame man, but the people around him. You see, sometimes your faith isn't strong enough when you're really sick to get you to Jesus or to have strength to believe and to receive that miracle. But if you'll surround yourself with people, they can take you in their faith, combined with your faith, to places you can't go on your own. He saw all of their faith. And he said to them, man, your sins are forgiven you. And then, of course, he got fried for that, and the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God? And when Jesus perceived or saw their thoughts, he answered and said, why are you reasoning in your hearts? What's easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or rise up and walk? In essence, it's a lot easier to just say your sins are forgiven you. You know, if I was going to say rise up and walk, that would be a real test of the anointing and the authority that's on my life. Verse 24, but that you may know that the Son of Man does have power on earth to forgive sins. So I want you to know that I can forgive sins. And by the way, they were right when they said no one can forgive sins but God alone. So when Jesus said that you may know I have the power to forgive sins, he's saying, I'm God. He said to the man who was paralyzed, I say to you, you're healed. And he laid his hands on him. No? He said, oh, Father in heaven, heal this man. He could have done that. He didn't do that. He spoke to him. Notice he didn't really even pray. He didn't even pray. He said, I say to you, arise. Now, just stop right there. He's paralyzed. He can't arise. The word arise in the Greek means to stand up around, to stand up, to change your posture, to go from a reclining or from a resting posture to an alert posture. It's an action word. It's typically used as the beginning step of starting to do something. It doesn't just mean get out of bed. It means get up and get ready for what's about to happen. And he said, arise, take up your bed, which he couldn't do, and go to your house. He's a paralyzed guy. He can't get up. He can't. He's been paralyzed all these years. He can't carry a bed, and he can't go to his house. But immediately, he rose up. which meant that, you know, the Holy Spirit didn't come and lift him up out of his bed and make him stand. He had to act on what Jesus said. His friends had already acted to bring him before Jesus. And now Jesus ministered to his heart condition, because this man, he wouldn't have said, your sins are forgiven you, if this man didn't have guilt in his life and wasn't dealing with sins that were breaking his soul. And so the Lord ministered to his soul first and then said, oh, and by the way, I want to minister to your body too. Now you have to do something. I want you to get up, act on this word. And so the man, you just got to picture this. You know, he's got a struggle. He's got to try. He starts lifting himself up, and then he's been paralyzed. Have you seen the legs of people who've been paralyzed for a long time? They're just bone and skins, without muscle. I mean, he had to. It wasn't. I don't think it was woo, instant. I think this guy had to struggle through this, get up, and begin to act on it. And as he did, the power of God met him at the point of his faith in action. And then the Lord said, go home. He hasn't walked. Now he's got to start walking and go home. I've seen the Lord heal people from different conditions, and I've seen numerous people who were bound for a long time get healed by the power of God. I saw one woman in Philadelphia literally get out of a wheelchair and walk for the first time in like 15 years. And as she began to walk, I would tell you, it wasn't just, she was just like, oof, because all of her muscles had not been used before. But as she began to walk, the power of God began to come on her. And the more she walked, the straighter she got. So we think, well, if it's not instant, it's not God. Very often, God is working through a process. Through a process. And so he rose up before them, took up what he'd been lying on, and departed to his house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed and glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, we've seen strange things today. Now look in Luke 6, next chapter. So we're in the same story. Luke is telling us how this healing ministry is growing. Verse 6, it says, now it happened on another Sabbath also that he entered the synagogue and taught. Jesus is teaching. And there was a man there whose right hand was withered. So the scribes and the Pharisees watched him closely, whether he would heal on the Sabbath, that they might find an accusation against him. They thought this would be if he does a healing, then he's doing a work, he's violating the Sabbath in their religious understanding. But how many of you know that if the Sabbath is designed for God, for people to meet with God and to worship God, wouldn't it be normal for God to want to minister to his people on the Sabbath? And he knew their thoughts, and he said to the man who had the withered hand, arise. The guy had to stand up. He said, arise and stand here. He said, get up and come here. Now, that man had to do that. His hand is still withered. He had to do that before any change took place in his body. He arose and he stood. In verse 9, it says, then Jesus said to them, I'll ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy? And when he looked around at them all, he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he did so, and his hand was restored as whole as the other. I want you to see, the man had to rise up and come to Jesus and stretch forth. He had to do something, and as he did it, God's power met him at the place of his faith. Jesus' power was present when the lame man was healed, but nobody got healed except those who acted in faith. God's power was present on this Sabbath, but it wasn't until the man rose and stood and then acted in faith that the healing power of God that was on Jesus went into operation in his life. Now look at Luke 6, verse 17. Just go to the 17th verse. It says, and he came down with them and stood on a level place with a crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea and Jerusalem, those would be the Jewish people, and from the seacoast of Tyre and Sidon. These are Gentiles. That's how Jesus' fame now had spread into the Gentile world. And so now these Gentiles are coming to receive from Jesus. You know, it's one thing to walk across the street, but if you're willing to take a trip, you're willing to get on a plane, you're willing to pack up a donkey and go, you know, what would have been 5, 6, 7 days journey, you got to want something. And they came to receive. Notice it says, They came, those from the coast, sea coast of Tyre and Sidon, who came to what? Hear him and be healed. To hear and be healed so he could teach them and then he could minister to them in the power of God. Verse 18, as well as those who were tormented with unclean spirits, and they were healed. Notice people who did have demonic work in their minds and their thinking was messed up. God healed them too. And verse 19, the whole multitude sought to what? Touch him. Read it out loud. What's it say? For power went out from him and healed them all. Now this in the Greek doesn't mean that he was intentionally, you know, distributing power. It was now just flowing out of him. It went out of him like wherever they were seeking, power went into them. Power went into them. Power. It just was going. Now, this is the same power that he came back from the wilderness anointed with the Holy Spirit and power. He walks into his hometown and he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach, to heal, to deliver the brokenhearted, set people free. I'm anointed to do this. Then he starts operating and teaching, and those who have faith start receiving from him. And as people see people receiving from that anointing that he said was on his life in Nazareth, but there was no demonstration of it, just he said, I'm anointed to heal you. Nobody received it because they couldn't get past their natural minds and doubts. But he goes into this other community, and people with faith start coming to Jesus. And as they begin to act on the things that he tells them to do, they begin to rise up, seek him, come to him, stretch forth their hand, get off their bed. As they begin to do something, the power of the Lord that was on him went into them and healed them. And it's building and building until you come to this place where now the crowds are coming from all over, even from far away, and they came to hear and be healed, and power is flowing out of him and healing them. Just they're getting ministered to. I believe that if we will teach the word on healing, if we'll keep proclaiming Jesus, that he is anointed, that he is a healer. And again, I'm not saying every single person's going to get healed every time. I would never say, I don't know. I don't control that. But we can't let what we don't know trouble what we do know. We can't let the pain of past experience, like the people in Nazareth, blind us to the presence of Jesus in our midst. And we just keep seeking. We keep pressing. There's got to be in the heart of the person who's struggling with depression and despondency and anxiety and the person that's struggling with physical pain. There has to be in you a passion to seek Jesus for whatever he has for you. And as we keep teaching the word and proclaiming the word, it creates an environment for the anointing that's on Jesus to flow out of him and begin to heal people. Praise the Lord. And I believe this conference this week is a place that we've set aside, a place where God's word can be preached and people can come to hear and be healed. Praise the Lord. Can you put your faith out for that? Now, this meeting over the next few weeks, tomorrow morning, Dr. Jorge Falero is going to minister. Dr. Falero is a dear friend. I love his testimony. Maybe he'll tell you some of it. This guy was an atheist, psychiatrist in Florida, and he got gloriously saved almost against his will. He didn't want to, but God sovereignly converted him. And then he worked in New York City as a psychiatrist and as an advisor to the legal system in New York, and then God moved him to Utica. And he works with troubled teens with all kinds of psychological issues during the week at the end of the Good Shepherd. And then on the weekends, he flies all over the world and preaches and prays for people. And this is a man who walks in both natural knowledge as well as supernatural knowledge. Because God can heal you through a supernatural means. He can heal you through medical means. He can heal you through good spirit-filled counseling. We are not opposed to any natural or spiritual means of healing. All healing comes from Jesus. Praise the Lord. So we're not saying throw away your medication. We're saying however the Lord wants to heal you, let's be open to it. Amen? We're going to have some breakouts that are going to talk about how to be healed in your soul and your mind and your emotions and of your pain, how to deal with those feelings of guilt and shame, because very often until that's healed, until the heart is healed, the body won't stay healthy because you want to have the whole thing. Tomorrow night, Christopher Alam is going to be with us, and he goes all over the world and preaches. He's a Muslim background believer from Pakistan who came to meet Jesus in Pakistan as a Muslim, had to leave the country because his life was under threat. Now he goes all over the world, including into Muslim nations, and preaches Jesus, and Jesus heals Muslims, Hindus. He heals animists in Africa. The Lord uses him to bring healing to people, not just Christians, but all kinds of people who haven't even met the Lord yet. And he's going to minister tomorrow night. Praise the Lord. And then, of course, we have Friday morning and Friday night. Carolyn Leaf is going to be here. And what an anointed woman she is. She's a neurobiologist, but she's also an anointed preacher of the gospel. So we're going to see God bring these streams together, and let's expect miracles. We have a room in the discipleship center on the second floor called the chapel, and in that room we have communion set up, and there's people that are going to be working before and after the services just there with an environment so that you can go and seek the Lord, receive prayer, receive communion. Even if you don't come to the altar to be prayed for, you can always go there and get prayed for before and after the services. We've really tried to design this conference so that whatever it is that people need, they can seek the Lord, and we're going to trust him for a miracle. Praise the Lord. Okay, let's bow our hearts right now before the Lord. I want to pray for you.